Welcome. My name is Bob Mnookin, and I chair the program on negotiation. And it's my enormous pleasure to welcome you to this, the 11th Great Negotiator Award. The program lays out some of the illustrious predecessors to Mr. Tommy Koh, but we are thrilled that he has joined us this week in Cambridge to let us honor him. My dean is going to formally introduce him, but let me just offer a couple of very brief observations. First, as you will read in the program, what an extraordinary career. And I can simply say that all of us in this community take enormous pride in his association with us and with Harvard. Kipling, he wrote once, praised a person who can walk with kings and not lose the common touch. I think you will discover by the end of this afternoon that marvelously captures our honoree. He has written about the need for courage, optimism, and a can-do spirit. He believes that most problems have solutions, that you can build institutions, that ideas are important. And so we here at the Program on Negotiation, who are very committed to the idea that theory can inform practice, are thrilled to have him as an honoree. Before introducing Dean, let me also make one other observation that I learned by doing just a tiny bit of background research. Ambassador Koh's life literally parallels the growth of modern Singapore. He was born shortly before the Japanese invaded and occupied Singapore. Following the war, the British Singapore once again became a British colony. And during the 50s, when he was in school, there was partial self-government, but quite limited self-government. While he was here at Harvard, Singapore became independent, but as part of Malaysia. It wasn't really independent. And indeed, shortly after he graduated, Singapore became independent of Malaysia. And his brilliant career, in fact, tracks the remarkable economic, political, and cultural development of modern Singapore. He, of course, is very much a man of the world, apart from a man of his own nation, and we have much to learn from him. I am thrilled that our dean is going to say a few words. We're so thrilled for over the years the support that Dean Minow and her predecessors have given to our program on negotiation. Dean Minow.
The United States and East Asia, conflict and cooperation, the quest for world order, perspectives of a pragmatic idealist. These are simply two of the titles of the great works of our honoree today, and they begin to hint at his range and his wisdom. It is, for me, a tremendous personal honor to be able to welcome and help recognize Ambassador Tommy Koh. The Great Negotiator Award is worth taking a moment to take it apart. Great and negotiator, what does this mean? Well, the negotiation part, I think everybody in the room knows, but it's worth mentioning. The dictionary definition is resolving disagreements, the reaching of agreement through discussion and compromise. But there's another definition which is also suitable for today, and it is navigation, the tackling of a hazard or a problem. And that is what the Program of Negotiation represents. It's extraordinary efforts to combine theory and practice under tremendous leadership of Bob Mnookin and the other directors. And their selection of Ambassador Tommy Koh couldn't better exemplify these abilities and the tackling of hazards or problems. Great. Now, what about the great part? Well, amazing, colossal, prodigious, stupendous, awesome. Those are the synonyms. As a short person myself, I'm delighted to find that this can be qualities associated with a short person. But I just have to tell you, if you don't know, here are some of the very superficial explanations about why he is so great. Ambassador at large at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Special Advisor of the Institute of Policy Studies, Chair of the Center for International Law at the National University of Singapore, Chair of the Sim Asia Foundation for Credit Suisse, Rector of the Tembusu College of University Town of National University of Singapore, Ambassador of the United States of America, President of the Third UN Conference of the Law of the Sea, Chairman of the Prep Committee for the Main Committee for the UN Conference on Environment and Development, Singapore's Chief Negotiator for the U.S.-Singapore Free Trade Agreement, the person who made it possible to resolve two critical land disputes between Singapore and Malaysia, UN Secretary General appointed to serve as the Special Envoy leading the mission to the Russian Federation, Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia, member of three WTO dispute panels. These are the biographical details, and they are extraordinary and appropriately so. I personally know that Ambassador Koh learned his negotiation skills during his critical stint as a law school dean. there's not enough laughter on that one, but that's just really, really true. His studies at the National University of Singapore and Cambridge University are complemented by his journey that brought him here. And he graduated 50 years ago. Ambassador Koh told me that he wondered whether this is like a revisiting of his award, of his degree studies, and are we going to reassess him? I can assure you, we are the ones who are so honored to learn from you, Ambassador Koh. His association with Harvard, though, is something that is indeed very, very special. And Ambassador Koh himself has spoken about really a lifelong association with Harvard. And I'm thrilled to be here welcoming him back. Here, he learned something about the passion that teachers have and can have for the law and how that can carry students well into their careers. He learned something about case studies, and therefore it's so very appropriate that we're going to spend this afternoon with case studies and launch the use of new case studies at the same time. He learned something about asking about the policy reasons behind laws and arguing about them and debating them. And he also developed his first connections with the United Nations while he was here as a student. And so if we played any part in his amazing journey, it is for us a great, great honor. It is for me a personal delight, since my father is a consul from Singapore to Chicago, Illinois, and his admiration for Ambassador Koh is so enormous, and so I convey that as well. It's my honor also to recognize other wonderful people here today, and they include Ambassador Karen Tan of Singapore and former ambassador from U.S. Ambassador to Pakistan, Cameron Munter. Thank you for being here, as well as everyone else who is here. Ambassador Koh said at one point, "We are kind, but could be kinder." That's an amazing sentence. We are kind, but could be kinder. And I think that is a window onto really behind the labels, behind the accomplishments, why he is so great and why he absolutely elevates the standard of the great negotiator. Egoless, thoroughly analytic, respectful, shrewd, hopeful, practical. Ambassador, we are honored to welcome you back to Harvard.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dean Minow, Bob Mnookin. My name is Jim Sabanias. I chair the Great Negotiator Program. But I want to take you back to something very personal. I see a number of my current students, many friends, many people in their 20s. That's when I had the good fortune to encounter Tommy Koh, who I initially addressed as ambassador and immediately Tommy, much preferred that. I'd heard something about the law of the sea. I knew it was vast, thousands of delegates, a constitution for the oceans. I knew that in the 1950s and the 1960s, that international law was in tatters over the law of the sea, that there were conflicts, even a shooting war between Britain and Iceland over cod, all kinds of conflicts on oil and on pollution and on transport and any number of subjects, and a law, international law simply was inadequate to the task. And I knew that major conferences at the UN had essentially failed to remedy this. Now, this was all sort of vague, but I ended up on the US delegation to the Law of the Sea negotiations, and by happenstance, very quickly, in a blatant conflict of interest, seconded to Tommy's staff. So I was the age of many of you, mid-20s, and perhaps a little full of myself. Some things don't change. In any case, what I remember is having been very analytical and studied game theory and the economics of bargaining and so forth, and then getting into the reality of a massive international negotiation and not realizing that the person I was ostensibly helping was a master in gestation. He'd been handed the worst thought to be killer aspect of this and one of the youngest ambassadors ever. And what I can tell you is doing the various tasks that Tommy assigned me over a couple of years in Geneva and New York, back and forth with the US delegation, I'm sure that that was pivotal for me in shifting my abiding lifelong interest to negotiation. And I didn't realize what a valuable teacher and mentor Tommy implicitly and humbly was. So it's a great chance to say thank you and to honor Tommy. We'll get very analytical very soon. But Susan Hackley, Managing Director of the Program on Negotiation, if you'd like to start the interrogation.
Oh, yeah. First, may I defend myself in the face of such high praise, most of which undeserved. I would like to reply in the following way. First, I want to say that I suffer from a good press. It's true, I suffer from it. Sometimes my government asks me, why is it that the New York Times doesn't like Singapore, but they seem to like you? I suffer from a good press. Secondly, a lot of my so-called achievements are the result of teamwork, of the collective efforts of many good men and women. You know, being the lucky leader of the team, I sort of bask in the glory of the good work of my colleagues, but I'm just the lucky leader, you know. And I must confess that everything I've done is a result of the collective efforts of many people. My third defense is whenever people praise me in such effusive terms, I always say in defense that I am the Forrest Gump of Singapore. For those of you who watch movies, you know who Forrest Gump is, right? But for those of you who do not watch movies, this is a wonderful movie in which Tom Hanks played the role of someone like me who's actually not very gifted, but who happens to be in the right place at the right time and achieve great things, you know? My wife thinks that's my story, you know? So I wanted to say that in self-defense. But I also want to say that on this specific project that the Conference on the Law of the Sea gave to me, which is to try to find an agreement on the financial terms of mining contracts for the deep sea bed, I had a little team that worked with me. And they included Jim, they included Kate Antrim here. Kate, why don't you stand up? Kate Antrim. They included John Bailey, Australian diplomat. John, please stand up. included Marty Powell. And one other colleague who has unfortunately passed away, Yoshida Shuni, very wonderful Japanese colleague from the UN. The Gang of Five, now Gang of Four. We worked very hard. We brainstormed, thought out of the box. We resort to very unusual techniques of negotiation. We persuaded the conference for the first time in maybe negotiating history to use a computer model, which had been built up by MIT as an instrument of negotiations. And we additionally persuaded delegations that they would submit their financial proposals and run them through the computer model to see whether or not the proposal were commercially viable, or whether they were so prohibitive, so onerous, that no sensible company or entrepreneur would consider investing in seabed mining. This was a tremendous achievement. Yeah, it was the collective work of this group of five, and we succeeded. It was partly because of good luck that MIT came up with this computer model at the opportune moment. It was because I asked my good friend Ambassador Elliot Richardson, the leader of the US delegation, to recruit these two super talented kids. They were kids then, Jim Sebanias and Kate Antrim, to the US delegation, and then to second them to me, to my staff. Yeah. So this is an example of the kind of successes I've had in my life, which are due to chance, good luck, and good colleagues. No.
So, Ambassador Koh, negotiation is considered a core skill of leaders, and leaders have to be able to negotiate effectively. In the U.S. Law of the Sea, you had thousands of delegates. It was the largest international conference ever held. Many over 100 countries. You had NGOs, civil society, scholars, economists, mm-hmm. mining engineers. You had every kind of stakeholder imaginable. And we'd love to hear a little bit from you about how you, as this young diplomat who was elected president of this whole conference by his peers, how you were able to get your arms around that and make sense of it. You talk about MIT being helpful in computers, talent spotting, finding the talented people to work with. But I'd love to have you talk a little bit about how you used consensus rather than voting and some of the different methods you used, which were quite innovative.
Okay. Forgive me for making a cheap commercial pitch. But I've actually written an essay in the book on the art of chairing major conferences. I think people have not really written about the art and science of chairing major conferences. I also have a short essay, not very good, on the 8 lessons I've learned from negotiations. But back to the art and science of chairing major international conferences. I've done it twice, the Law of the Sea Conference and then the Earth Summit. The chairman of the conference is both a choreographer and a conductor of an orchestra. You are a choreographer because you've got to design a conference structure. You don't interview colleagues, but you sort of evaluate them to who you think will qualify to play in the orchestra, who could be section leaders. So when I was chairman of a conference, I designed a structure in both the Law of the Sea Conference and in the PrepCom from the Earth Summit. The formal structure was that there were three committees. I had no choice in choosing the leaders of the three committees. This was done by geographical rotation, you know, so Africa elects one chair. As I was Asian, so Asian didn't have a turn, but the European elect one chair, Eastern Europe elect one chair. So I had to work with these three colleagues. In addition, the agenda was so comprehensive. It was clear to me that just this formal conference structure was inadequate to deal with the many issues and challenges in both conferences. So I asked the conference permission to appoint negotiating groups. So I had many negotiating groups. I then had the responsibility to talent spot the people whom I think will do a good job chairing these negotiating groups. And I evaluate their performances. If they do not perform, I had to steel my heart. You know, I'm a very soft-hearted, sentimental, and romantic person. Yeah, in my 50-year career, I've never dismissed an employee. You know? So, you know, I don't have a tough heart. But when I was chairing a conference, I felt it was incumbent on me to be tough. And if I felt that a colleague was not adequate to the job, not because he was not knowledgeable enough, but sometimes we have failings, you know? Some people are indecisive. Some people lack courage so that when the time has come to close a deal, they don't do it. They miss that moment. So I had to steel my heart and replace them. Yeah. So it was my job as the choreographer and the director of the orchestra to change the section leaders, to hold them accountable. But at the same time, I wanted to create this feeling that we are a collective leadership. And so I created, in addition to the formal bureau, which is often too big to be functional, I created an informal conference leadership consisting of the chairman of the three major committees, consisting of the chairman of all the negotiating groups, consisting of the chairman of the major regional and interest groups. And we collectively was the steering committee of the conference. And I used to meet them every day in critical moments, even twice a day, just to evaluate progress, to find out where the problems are and how do we help that particular negotiating group to resolve the problem, if possible. In the meantime, I have to keep the proletariat happy, you know, because we live in a democratic world. So I had to regularly meet the big bureau to brief them what's going on. I would hold regular plenary meetings. So it was necessary in designing the structure that you must keep the plenary happy. You must let everybody know what's going on. Hold no secrets from them. You must pay respect to the bureau, even though the bureau is dysfunctional. You must create a steering committee of the collective leaders of the conference. And then you must appoint able women and men to lead the negotiating groups. And most of all, you want to create a certain spirit, a camaraderie, that we may be representing our respective countries. John's representing Australia. I'm representing Singapore, and so on, but that we transcend these national interests, that we have a higher objective, which is to bring the conference to a successful conclusion, and that what we are working for is a fair and balanced outcome. And you know, if you are a good leader, you will find these people, and you bring them into your collective leadership, and you form a formidable thought leadership, a majority. And the troublemakers get marginalized. But that's another question.
So you talked about the time is right to close a deal. Yeah. And sometimes the time is wrong.
Yeah.
And I think someone you appointed during the Earth Summit had a not clear sense of timing, and there was issues of replacement and progress and momentum.
Yeah.
Could you give us that example?
Yeah. In any negotiation, you must have a good instinct for knowing when the time has come to close a deal. And I give you one example. When I was chairing the preparatory committee for the Earth Summit, we had three committees. The responsibility for drafting the Rio Declaration of Principles was assigned to the third committee. And the third committee was chaired by a very distinguished scientist from Czechoslovakia, Dr. Bedřich Modrý, who was the Minister for the Environment of Czechoslovakia. Very good man. But he was a good scientist, but inexperienced in terms of international politics and conference diplomacy. He had not had the benefit of going to Kennedy School, I think. And he was very focused on his work, you know. So Dr. Modrý looked at all the competing principle proposals of the different delegations, and he then took it upon himself to write a chairman's compromise text. Yeah. He gave this chairman's compromise text to the delegations. But much to his surprise and unhappiness, the developing countries, through their trade union, the Group of 77, rejected the paper. They perceived the paper as biased against developing countries and in favor of developed countries. I think it was more perception than reality, you know, but one of the things you learn in international relations is that sometimes perception prevails over reality. So this became stuck, you know, the perception was this paper by the chair is not a neutral text. And worse, I think maybe through his rather austere personality and demeanor and his failure to fraternize, the developing country decided that he was not a neutral chairman. And so they decided they will no longer negotiate under his chairmanship. This is terrible rebuff to him, you know. I refused to intervene. I said, no, I must stand by this man. He's been elected chairman of Committee 3. He will chair the negotiation. They said, we will not negotiate under him. So what they did was that they elected India and Norway as the co-chairman of their informal negotiation. So negotiation proceeded under India and Norway. And this went on for several weeks. Then they reached an impasse. So India and Norway came to see me and said, Chairman, we think the time has come for you to intervene. You know, we've reached an impasse. We can't take it further. And I decided to go back to Dr. Bedřich Modrý and ask his permission, whether he would be offended if I were to take over the negotiation. He said, no, please do it. I was in a position of strength because India and Norway were supplicants, you know. I was in a position of strength. I was in a position to dictate terms to them. I said, I will take over the negotiation on two conditions. First, you, the two co-chair, India and Norway, produce for me in 24 hours a single negotiating text. You can bracket disputed language, but I don't want two pieces of paper, one piece of paper. And I give you 24 hours to get it done, which they accepted. Second, my second condition was a tougher one. I said, I'm willing to chair a negotiating group of only 16 countries. 8 representing the developing countries and 8 representing the developed countries. And you choose who your representatives are. And we will start negotiation in 24 hours, which we did. The timing was right. I think the composition of the 2 delegations was good. And we worked round the clock and completed our job in 24 hours. You know. So it's an example where when the timing is right, and there is will on the part of the competing party to seek a compromise, a neutral chairman seizing that moment but creating the right format could close the deal.
So it's interesting. This chair really focused on the substance,
yes,
not the process. He wasn't asked to produce this document, but produced it anyway. The perception was that it was tilted. You held back until they reached an impasse, almost a crisis, and then stepped in as you described. Was the ultimate deal really different from what he proposed up front?
I can't give you a very precise answer. I think it was philosophically a different paper. I first of all look at the Stockholm Declaration, because Rio was not the first international conference on the environment, it was the second. And I was lucky enough to have participated in the preparatory committee for the first conference in Stockholm. And so I look for inspiration from the Stockholm Declaration. I also look for inspiration to the Brundtland Commission. In fact, I shamelessly stole the concept of sustainable development from Mrs. Brundtland. And then being from the developing world, I was much more politically sensitive to the aspirations of the developing country than would Dr. Mauldin be, you know? So I was much more sensitive to the need to reconcile the developing country's aspiration to achieve economic development on the one hand, and to do it with as little damage as possible to nature, to the environment, and to our ecosystems. Yeah, I mean, that was my perspective. And I think being seen as a man from the South was psychologically helpful, even if the content was not different. But somehow the author, you know, being from the South, was seen by the developing country as somebody who understood the aspiration, and who could capture this golden mean between development on the one hand and environment on the other.
As I recall, many of the principles just got moved around in the document also.
Yeah.
So the principles key to the South all of a sudden became early.
Yeah.
And similar principles toward the end, important to the North, were still there, but in a different place.
Yeah.
Analytically, it's identical, but not politically.
Not politically.
And you're from a small country, and John Bailey's from a very large country, Australia, and...
The Australians think they are a big country, but actually it's a...
So could you say a little bit about how you manage that process, and then we see this in many environmental meetings and other kinds of conferences where there are, you have superpowers, you have little island nations, you have landlocked countries, you have people with all different inroads into this kind of discussion. How do you look at this, and do you encourage them to form coalitions? How do you handle the outliers?
Yeah, well, in the Law of the Sea conference, countries identify their own interests, and those with kindred interests would form coalitions or interest groups of their own. So for example, countries with broad continental shelves, they would form a group. Landlocked countries would form a group. Countries that, like my own country, which are geographically hemmed in by our neighbors, and are unable to claim extensive maritime zones. We call ourselves geographically disadvantaged states, and we would form our group. And we subsequently merged with the landlocked group. Then the archipelagic states, they would form a group. Countries that hosts of international straits, like Spain, Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, Bahrain, and others, they would form a group of strait states. Countries that have strong fishing interests, not just coastal fishing, but long-distance fishing, they would have a caucus of their own. And in addition to this, there were groups formed, like there's a group that John belongs to, the AN, the Cairns group, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. I always thought this was a bit of a fraud, you know. These three countries were seeking a role, you know. And they very cleverly formed themselves as Cairns, the Canadian, Australian, New Zealand. They would always demand a seat at the table. They said, no, we are Cairns. We are not part of the West European and others group. Please give us a seat at the table. Then, of course, you have the big regional groups. So there are many, many groups. In a way, it's good, because then you're clear what the interest groups are. And when you are negotiating a specific issue, you invite to the table those who've got relevant interests. You don't need to invite to the table other groups that have no relevant interest. You know. So, and of course, there was one group consisting of only two countries, the United States and the Soviet Union, the two superpowers.
You know, we all try to figure out how these massive groups and hundreds, even thousands of delegates can possibly be organized. And you've given us a hint of that. But in your writings, which are remarkable and betray your academic roots, because after every negotiation in which Tommy was involved, there either was one or two articles or a book on the process of that. So we're very much the beneficiaries. One of the consistent themes was a tactic that you called miniaturization. And I remember watching 160 adamant players in the seabed mining talks all of a sudden shrink to Mauritius, the United States, Argentina, and Pakistan. And that's where the deal happened. Could you talk more about this, you know, this miniaturization and then expansion back out as a tool of consensus building? How to do it, what goes wrong, what works?
One of the big challenges of the contemporary world is that we have over 190 sovereign states, all of which demand a seat at the table, and there's, you know, it's not possible to deny anybody a seat at the table. So when a plenary meets, 20, 30 years ago it was 150 countries, then 60, now it's 195 countries. When you are negotiating in a plenary of 195 countries, it's extremely difficult, extremely difficult. I wouldn't say it's impossible, extremely difficult to achieve a consensus or compromise. So one of the challenges of a chairman is, how do I move from a plenary of 195 to a smaller negotiating forum, and eventually to a very small negotiating forum that will close the deal? Well, in the case of the negotiation on the financial terms of mining contracts, we began in a room of about 150 countries. And it was necessary to have meetings at 150 countries because you're indulging in public education. You need to bring everybody up to speed on what are the issues, what are the parameters, what are the various scenarios. Explain to them all the technical terms so that they understand what does IROR, what does internal rate of return mean, you know? What are the different kind of tax policy and mining contracts? So there was a need for general public education at the plenary level. Once that's accomplished, you have to make a transition from this huge plenary group to a smaller forum. And what we collectively did, and it's not a trick, you know, it's just that I felt the moment was ripe to make a transition. So I invented a new group called the Group of Financial Experts. And I picked a meeting room that could accommodate maximum 40 people. It was open-ended, nobody's name, you know, anybody could come. But just by calling it the Group of Financial Experts was somewhat intimidating, you know. So a lot of my colleagues felt that they didn't qualify to join this group. I didn't try to dissuade them that they did. And so most people didn't come, so about 30 to 40 colleagues came. And he gave us in a smaller forum to advance the collective knowledge about the problem. And this went on for a while until again, you know, you need this instinct. Again, when I felt, hey, we're ready to close the deal, I took a great risk. I could have been rebuffed and it would have been a terrible outcome, but I took a high risk and decided the time had come to close the deal, and I had this very small negotiating group. As John said, I picked only one person, Elliot Richardson, to represent the whole developed world, and three colleagues you mentioned. A colleague from Pakistan, Ul Haq, to represent Asia. Anu Gayan from Mauritius to represent the whole Africa. And he's not even from the continent of Africa, but from Mauritius, you know. But he was well accepted by his African brother, sister, as a financial expert and very knowledgeable about the subject. And a colleague from Argentina represented Latin America. And it was in this little group that the final deal was closed. Now, you have to pick these final negotiators carefully. They must be men and women standing in their respective groups so that they can bring the product of our negotiation back and get it ratified by the group. If you choose badly, you will be rebuffed, you know. So we were very lucky that the outcome of this small group negotiation was ratified by the respective groups and by the plenary.
But Tommy, you said no secrets, no secret negotiation groups, and yet this group was negotiating privately, and everyone knew it. Nobody had elected these people. Nobody was bound to the result. How do you square that with a no secrets and no secret groups policy that you've adopted?
No, in the Law of the Sea conference, I had not yet learned the lesson. No, I'm serious. I mean, you learn as you go along, you know? I had not yet learned the lesson that it is, on the whole, a bad thing to constitute secret negotiating groups. Because most of the time, people not involved in a group will resent this. And even if they like the outcome, they'll rebuff the outcome just because the process is undemocratic and not transparent.
You talk about this process that you think is healthy and productive of confrontation, crisis, and resolution. Do you think one of the skills you have and that master negotiators need to have is the ability to be comfortable in high stakes, maybe even emotional, maybe even values-laden negotiations, to be comfortable with confrontation?
I guess I'm just lucky that I'm born with a nature that doesn't get easily ruffled, you know. And I've actually learned to welcome confrontation and crisis. I mean, it makes me sound like a pervert, right? but having watched so many negotiations, I realized that very often you need a confrontation and a crisis before a resolution. Yeah. And if you are astute and you are in a position to intervene, then you intervene during the crisis and bring the parties together and find a resolution.
I'm very impressed with the many, many negotiations you've done, how you're able to bring them over the finish line, where there are actually agreements signed, voted on, the Cambodia, some of the topics you'll talk about in the afternoon, that you really get the deal done and you get closure.
I wonder if I could take this to another barrier. This issue of, you know, complexity, of using an analytic model to even out the level of expertise and understanding, to kind of make these things tractable with this almost sociological process of finding the right people. But always in these negotiations are spoilers, are blockers. And there's an interesting example of the time in Rio when you looked at the overall process and you said, I can see trouble coming down the way, because if forestry principles are to be part of this Earth Summit outcome, there's a brewing tendency, in particular, to in the developing world, and championed by your near neighbor to the north, to say, this has no place, the developing world should be subject to no regulation, treaty, or otherwise. Now, as chair, you could see that coming, and if that prevailed, it would cause great problems with the overall convention. Seeing that, how did you approach the problem?
As chair of a negotiation, you want to achieve consensus. You try to be as democratic as possible. You try to give everybody every opportunity to express his or her point of view. Let me give you three examples, not one. In the last meeting of the preparatory committee in New York, I was telling you that the draft Rio Declaration of Principle was negotiated in a group of 16, you know? So I had to present this product of our negotiation to the plenary. And I remember this was on St. Patrick's Day, 1992. I thought, you know, everybody would be happy with this draft because, you know, it was negotiated by 16, but very representative group. But to my surprise, one delegation was adamantly opposed to it, the delegation of Israel. Israel said, no, this draft declaration is unacceptable. Why? Why did Israel oppose this? Because one of the principles in a draft declaration is a principle about the need to protect people in occupied territories. And you know, to the Israelis, they're very sensitive about this. I was aware that this was a hot potato, and in a group of 16, when the issue was raised, I told my colleagues that be very careful in the manner in which we formulate this. And don't try to think of any new language. Let us use existing treaty language which has universal support. So we look at the Geneva Convention and pick up the language from the Geneva Convention, which most countries find acceptable. Israel, unfortunately, not one of them. So my Israeli friends keep filibustering me all night long and said, no, they cannot accept this. Well, I was presented with a dilemma, you know, do I allow one delegation to block consensus? I decided that consensus doesn't mean unanimity, you know, that of the maybe 150 countries, only one country found it objectionable. The rest of them do not. So the Israeli delegation asked for a recess, which I granted them a recess. We had a private meeting, and I do not wish to review what transpired in a private meeting. We went back to the plenary, and I told my Israeli friends that as the chairman, I'm going to rule that there's a consensus in favor of adopting the real declaration of principles. You can oppose me. I said, please, oppose me. And if you oppose me, I will put your objection to the vote. And let's see whether you have any support, you know. So they decided not to oppose me. And I managed to get it through, you know.
But you had a second round to that process, right?
Yes, but you see, I didn't want to tell my Israeli friend that I was actually doing them a big favor. They were so angry with me, you know. I think at that moment, they probably would declare me PNG, you know, and that I would be barred from visiting Israel. They thought I was an enemy of Israel, but what they did not understand was that I was actually doing them a big favor. Because when we went to Rio, and we had this maybe 300-page Agenda 21, Agenda 21 was full of anti-Israeli language, which the PLO and their friends had inserted, you know. So I had a plan, which I didn't want to tell the Israelis. But before I executed the plan, I had to isolate the PLO. And this is where both wholesale and retail diplomacy is very important. I had, the Arab group was so impressed by my behavior in New York, you know. They saw that I did not give in to the intimidation of the Israeli, so they all came to kiss me three times on my cheeks and call me a brother. So we're not used to kissing each other on our cheeks, and certainly not three times, you know. So they embraced me as brother. So to them, I've proven that I'm a brother. And then I spoke quietly to the Iranians, because the Iranians like to profile themselves as a champion of the Palestinians, you see. So I explained to my Iranian colleagues, who are highly intelligent people, you know. So never underestimate the Iranian, they're highly intelligent people. So I told the Iranian that I've done the Palestinian a favor. It's in the draft declaration. Here in Rio, I need your support. I said, as a last item on the agenda, I'm going to propose that we delete from Agenda 21 all anti-Israel language. So the Arab group supported me, the Iranians supported me. So I was quite confident that the PLO would know that if they fought me, they would be all alone, just as Israeli was all alone in New York. So I, as a matter of tactic, I dealt with all outstanding issues first until everything is finished, and precisely at 6 o'clock in the morning, we had worked through the night without a break, you know. Our final meeting in Rio began at 8 p.m., and we concluded our meeting at 6 a.m. in the morning. So last item on the agenda. I said, colleagues, I have one final item to put to you, and the two are linked. I'm going to ask you to adopt, by consensus, the real declaration of principles on the one hand, and my proposal to delete from Agenda 21 all language targeted at Israel or refer to occupied territories. And I look at the Israeli, look at the PLO delegation. I look him in the eye, and I counted 1, 2, 3 to see whether he would raise his hand. I was so happy he didn't raise his hand. Bang the camel.
Counting
so I got
Counting fast plus sleep deprivation is...
So, I mean, frankly, if I had not done what I did in New York, I would not have carried the Arab group and the Iranians with me in Rio. And this is, remember, 92, before Oslo Accord, you know? So there was a conflict between the Palestinian and Israelis. So this was another example. And the third example, I hope there are no Saudi friends here. Again, in Rio, when I arrived in Rio, I was quite desperate, you know. We had 1 week to clean up 300 paragraphs of disputed language. Disputed language are language with square brackets around them. 1 week. So I enunciated two rules. Rule number one, that no language that is unbracketed will be reopened for discussion. My second rule is, any proposal to improve the language of a bracketed text that meets with a single objection fails. Yeah. So the Saudi asked for the floor and said, Mr. Chairman, I want to delete the whole chapter on atmosphere. And I say, my brother, did I listen correctly? You want me to delete the whole chapter of atmosphere that is a consensus text, unbracketed? They say, yes, it was a mistake. There should have been a brackets around it. I say, well, the records are here, you know. You can check the records. But they kept filibustering me. Yeah. But again, I preempted them because as a good chairman, you need to think of how you should outflank your adversary, you know? So I spoke individually to all the OPEC members. Yeah. I spoke to all the OPEC members to say, this is a very unreasonable demand. This is a clean text. After all, in Rio, we are opening for signature the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change. How can we have an Agenda 21 with no chapter on atmosphere? Not possible. The OPEC members all agreed with me. I then spoke quietly to each of the Arab countries that was in a recipient of Saudi aid, because I knew that Saudi would put pressure on them to speak up for them, you know? So I spoke to them to explain the issue and to say, I understand the dilemma you are in, you know. If you feel that you have to speak and support the Saudi Arabia, please do so. But please be very brief and, you know, make your argument as weak as possible. and again, as in the case of Israel and New York, I allowed the Saudi delegation to filibuster me the whole night long until I think people in the room got quite fed up, you know. And then I said, well, with respect, I think we've given you many opportunities to explain your position. The time has come for the chair to rule. And I'm going to rule that there's consensus to adopt the chapter on atmosphere. And if you are opposed to my ruling, you can oppose me, and I'll put your objection to the vote. Again, they chose not to do that. So my point is that consensus is not unanimity, right? And if you're in a chair, don't make the mistake that a single objection represents no consensus. If somebody is just being difficult, doesn't have a reasonable case, has no support whatsoever, I think it is incumbent upon you as the chair not to allow this one delegation to hijack the process.
So Tommy, these are cases of holdouts, and fascinating how you handled it. But what about a wholesale blocking entity, as you saw potentially developing on forests? How did you see that, and then what steps did you take in response?
Are there any Malaysian brothers and sisters in the room?
There we go.
Please forgive me if I offend you, huh? I was trying to avoid Jim's question, but it looks like he wouldn't let me get away with this one. You remember that in the 1960s, 70s, even early 80s, the world was very polarized, not just between East and West, but between North and South, you know? And some people in the South wanted to make the environment a polarizing issue, a divisive issue between North and South. And forests was one such issue. There were two points of view. One point of view, the Western view, is that yes, all countries have a right to exploit their natural resources, but you should do it in a sustainable manner. That if you look at the remaining rainforests of the world, those in Brazil and in Southeast Asia, that you could say there's a transcendent global interest because they are the green lungs of the world. And it would be very damaging to the global interest if these remaining rainforests were to be rapidly depleted, deforested. In the developing world, there were two points of view, the moderate view and the not so moderate view. The moderate view is that, yes, we understand what you, the North, is saying to us, but you also understand that for us, our natural resources include our forests, and that for the livelihood of our people, we need to use our forest resources. You can help to teach us how to do it in a more sustainable manner, but you have no right to stop me from cutting down my trees. The more radical view in the South, and the distinguished Prime Minister of Malaysia, Dr. Mahathir, was a champion of this more radical view, is that you in the North have no right to be giving me lectures. You have depleted your own forest, and now you are telling me not to cut down my forest. I'm a sovereign country. My forests are my resources. I can do what I want to them. So there was a danger in Rio that there would be a confrontation over forests. So one of my challenges was, how do I diffuse this? How do I prevent forests from becoming a divisive issue rather than an issue that brings North and South together, that we have a common responsibility to help developing countries use their natural resources, including the forest resources, but in a manner that's sustainable. You know, that's my objective.
And the distinguished Prime Minister of Malaysia was an eloquent, galvanizing figure, attracting quite a following.
Oh yeah. No, he was a remarkable man, and his, in his, I think, 22 years as Prime Minister of Malaysia, he transformed Malaysia, you know. And he's charismatic, eloquent, not afraid to take on anyone. In fact, he rather enjoy taking on, the West. So what do I do? And being a citizen from the neighboring countries, maintaining good relations with Malaysia, paramount, you know. And I had to show respect for the Prime Minister and not do or say anything that is disrespectful. So what I decided to do is to adopt a strategy that would take away his constituency. I began with Africa. I told myself that if I can take away the African constituency, then Dr. Mahathir will not succeed in mobilizing the whole of the Third World to support his very radical position on forests. So, and my feeling for the Africans, sincere, not just tactical, no? Because I, in my long years as ambassador to the UN, I had a very close relationship with my African brothers and sisters. And one of the first thing I did in Rio was to ask to meet the African group. I think no chairman has ever done that. I asked to meet the African group. And I asked the African group, what is your number one environmental challenge in Africa? And how can I help you? And the African group told me that the number one environmental challenge was the danger that their marginal lands were turning into deserts. Yeah. And that their pleas for help to the West had fallen on deaf ears. And what they wanted from me is a deliverable from the Earth Summit that would give the UN a mandate to convene a negotiating conference to adopt a new agreement to combat desertification. For the African group, this is number one. So I told my African brothers and sisters that I will make it my number one, you know, and deliver. So I managed to persuade the EU, which was chaired by the Netherlands, fortunately for me, a good country and sympathetic to the Africans. I got the EU support. The US delegation was not able to support this proposal because it was an election year, 92, and President Bush was concerned about his own right wing, and he decided to take a very low profile in Rio, conceding the natural leadership role to the Europeans. And I asked the US delegation, can you support this proposal? They said, we don't have a mandate. And again, I was saved by either divine intervention, if you believe in God, or by chance, if you don't believe in God. But there was a Senate delegation that visited Rio, consisting of four very eminent senators, Al Gore, Tim Worth, John Kerry, Bob Kerry. I invited them to have dinner with me, and they asked me, is there anything we can do to help you? I said, yes, just do one thing for me. When you go back to Washington, see President Bush and ask President Bush to give new instructions to your delegation in Rio to support the African request. That's all I ask him. And they returned to Washington, they saw President Bush, and President Bush issued such instructions. So I got European and African, American support. The support from the Third World was a given, you know. So I was able to go back to the African group and say, I think I have consensus to give to the UN such a mandate as you have requested. My African brothers and sisters said to me, you have proven yourself to be a true brother. So I was a brother to many people, no? The Arabs and other Africans. And they said to me that whatever support you need from me, you can count on us.
Did you need India and China in this?
Yes. So I told the Africans that when it comes to forests, I plead with you not to take an extreme position, but a middle position. That the forests are yours, you have a right to exploit them, but do it in a sustainable way, you know. And then I decided to take away two other major constituents from Dr. Mahathir, and these are China and India. I was on very good terms with the Chinese and Indian delegations, and when I explained to them what my objective was, both the Chinese and Indian delegations said I had the support, you know. So I knew that without being offensive, without saying anything rude, without confronting Dr. Mahathir, I had taken away the Third World constituency from him. And I then decided to appoint a very powerful person, the German Minister for the Environment, Dr. Klaus Töpfer, to chair the negotiations on forests. And he did a very good job. We were not ready in Rio to adopt a set of binding principles, but we did the next best thing, we succeeded in achieving consensus in adopting a set of non-binding principle on forests, which is a beginning, you know, of this journey. So this is the happy story I want to tell you. And I hope my Malaysian brother is not offended. No.
So this is very interesting. The road to dealing with a potentially fatal blockage on forests led through deserts. And bringing that issue in through the EU, through the US, the Indians, the Chinese, not in the least diminishing the capacity of the Malaysian Prime Minister to make powerful statements, to be prominent on the world stage, but at the end of the day, you had an acceptable forestry yes. outcome.
Yeah. And I did one other thing. I wanted to show the Malaysian that I'm not unfriendly to Malaysia. So I picked the leader of the Malaysian delegation, a very talented diplomat, to chair one of the negotiating groups. Because I wanted, while depriving Dr. Mahathir of, you know, his political objective, which is to galvanize the third world behind his position on forests, but I, at the same time, I wanted to show what the Malay would say, how much of honor, respect for Malaysia, by deliberately picking a very capable Malaysian diplomat to be chairman of one of the negotiating groups.
One of the things you've said that I've been struck by is that the beginning of wisdom is understanding that we each live within a cultural box. And it seems to me that you have this deep cultural understanding that's really global. And another thing that we've noted is your incredible network that you've developed over decades and that you can call on at different times and people can call on you. And you've talked about intellectual intelligence, emotional intelligence, but cultural intelligence being just as important.
Yeah, I think at Harvard, huh? And in Singapore, we maybe overemphasize cognitive intelligence. Harvard is full of super bright people. And in Singapore, we worship bright people, you know. But we forget in Singapore that human beings operate at two levels. We think with our head, but we also think with our heart. You know? And very often, good public policies are not well received by the public. Why? Because in the making of the policy, in the explanation of the policy, in the execution of the policy, we had forgotten the need to communicate with our hearts. I would say the same in negotiations and in diplomacy. I'm always conscious that when I deal with another country, another group of countries, I have to connect with them intellectually, I have to connect with them emotionally, I have to connect with them culturally. So before I prepare to negotiate with any country or group of countries, I take time to study their history, their culture, their taboos, their body language, what's acceptable, what's not acceptable, their negotiating style. And I think it's important, you know? I mean, if you deal, especially in ASEAN, you know, in ASEAN, you see, Singaporeans are the barbarians of Southeast Asia. This is all big tape, is it? I mean, we...
Selectively.
We are... Oh, I take that back. But let me put it more politely. I wouldn't say we're barbarian, but I would say that we are so westernized. We are so westernized. We are so...
Barbarian.
No, we're not. We are so... We are so Aristotelian in our logic system. We have no understanding of alternative systems of logic and thinking that other people may think elliptically and not linearly. We are very straightforward. Like, we love Americans, and Americans love us because we are straightforward. We tell you exactly what we think. We are very fact-based, very evidence-based. We are very transactional, you know. But other people are not like that, you know. I'll give you an example of negotiating with my Korean brothers and sisters. One of my happy jobs is I was asked to be the founding executive director of the Asia Europe Foundation. And for me, this is such a great fortune because I spent all my life in America. I'm an Americanist. I've never served in Europe and have very little understanding of European history, the European integration project, the fact that Europe is not a monolith, but many cultures in this continent. But it also gave me an opportunity to work for the first time with fellow Asians. Because the family consists of the ASEAN country, but also of China, of Japan, and of India, of the South Korea, you know? So I'll give you one example of the difference between Singaporeans and Koreans. So the Koreans were hosting the second Asia-Europe summit in Seoul in the year 2000. So I was the CEO of the Asia Foundation, the Asia-Europe Foundation. The Koreans said, could I help them to organize on the sidelines of the summit the same kind of cultural and intellectual program that I had done in London 2 years earlier, you know? And I said, of course I would do that. Then they said, can we send a delegation to Singapore to negotiate an MOU with you? I said, absolutely. So in the usual Singapore efficient way, I sort of allocated 2 hours. Yeah. So, okay, why don't you come here on a Sunday? Then we meet on Monday morning. We should finish the negotiation in 1 to 2 hours. I will take you to a great French restaurant for lunch, and then you can go home, you know? But no, they want to spend 2 days in Singapore. And then they said, we finish our work, but tonight we must go together, we must go to a dinner and go drinking, you know? And then I said, well, I'm not a drinking type, you know? But fortunately, on my staff, I had interns from France and Ireland and a French deputy who loved to drink, you know. So I said, well, if you forgive me, I won't join you. But we will host a dinner for you. And then I said, my deputy, my French colleague will take my place. And then I said, these beautiful interns from France and Ireland and so on will join you. And they had a great time, you know. And then they said, oh, the next day they want to spend in Sentosa. It's a resort island, you see. And we must reciprocate your hospitality with another great dinner and a big karaoke session, you know. So you see that even within Asia, there are different ways of doing this. So, you know, so we Singaporeans are often not understanding of how other people operate in their cultural box. We just think that they are like us, you know, very business-like, very bottom line oriented, very frugal on time, get a job done, host a meal for you and say goodbye. But to the Koreans that visited Singapore, not successful until we had two dinners and two drinking sessions, you know.
We may have time for a couple of questions. So from the, not much time, right? This is one of your tactics. So really the floor, we have many faculty, many students, many interested people.
And we have a microphone.
Professor Henriksen of the Fletcher School.
Alan has been my lifelong teacher.
Thank you. This is really a great honor to be here with you and join in honoring you and the work you've done in diplomacy. My question concerns the negotiation of ratification. You've emphasized the various factors involved in closing the deal, you know, producing an agreement, producing a consensus, producing a treaty in some cases. My question is, does the process of building a consensus through formation of coalitions, groups, and so on, does that carry through, in your experience, into the international ratification process, particularly with regard to the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea?
Yeah. Alan, being a foreigner, I'm not in a position to help build a coalition to encourage the Senate to ratify the treaty. But I will give you a different example. As you know, I was a chief negotiator of the US-Singapore Free Trade Agreement. And it is one thing to conclude the agreement, it's another thing to get it ratified by Congress. We were very conscious while we were negotiating this agreement that we must make sure to keep members, key members of the Congress, in the loop, so that when the deal is done, there's a sense of ownership by the House and the Senate. So that is something we do. We don't do this in any other country, you know. But the American democracy is a unique democracy. You not only negotiate the executive branch, you negotiate the legislative branch. But more than that, we are also negotiating with your private sector. I was spending a lot of time with the US Chamber of Commerce, the Manufacturers Association, with all the business lobbies and interest groups that were pro-free trade, so that I want them to be part of to be champions of the agreement and to neutralize those that could oppose me. And not only that, I also reach out to the NGOs. And my colleague at the embassy, Ambassador Chan, who is a brilliant woman, she created two caucuses, a caucus of American business to support the free trade agreement, and she created a congressional caucus of 59 members to support Singapore. So we did all that. It was a campaign, you know. Negotiating with the United States on agreement and getting it through the Congress is a campaign. And I've written about this, so please buy a copy of my book.
We will focus on
that. I have another book on the US-Singapore free trade. but you know, I keep telling all my friends serving in America for the first time and who are unfamiliar with America that America is a unique democracy, you know? You have to understand how America works. And if you don't, then you will not be effective here.
We will talk about in more detail the free trade agreement and the multi-front campaign and so forth. But Alan's question about ratification, there are a lot of ratifications of the Law of the Sea Convention.
Yeah, I know.
And so it's, in fact, other questions. Yes,
I think there's a lady in front also, no?
Yeah. Yes, huh? Please.
I think the lady in front, you wanted to ask a question, right?
And please identify yourself and...
Thank you very much, Ambassador Koh. This is a delight and distinct honor to be present and listen to you. I've served for 3 years in your wonderful country for the UN. And I would like to follow up on Professor Henriksen's questions on the ratification, relating it to the 51 Geneva Convention relating to the status of refugees, which the Philippines have ratified and all Southeast Asian countries not yet. And so my question comes how from the inside towards outside the ratification process might be positively advanced. Are there regional agreements as far as you see which advocate a position to yes or not to ratify particular conventions? And there would be a plea after the 60 years of the UN High Commissioner for Refugees to perhaps consider giving a good word for the ratification in due course. by Singapore and by the Southeast Asian countries, if I may.
Yeah, thank you. Do you work for the UN High Commissioner for Refugees?
Yes.
Yeah, it is a truly admirable institution, and I was very happy that former Commissioner Sadako Ogata was a winner of the Negotiator Award. And I recently chaired a public lecture in Singapore by Janet Lim, who's the assistant, assistant commissioner. What was your question? I've forgotten what I got. Would Singapore please ratify? When Ambassador Karen Tan comes later, maybe you can ask her the question. I don't have the authority to do that. But our problem about, we don't have a very good record of ratifying international conventions. And the reason is that we're over meticulous, you know? Many countries take a very cavalier attitude and just sign and ratify all kinds of conventions, not worrying very much whether they will actually implement them. But we actually take very seriously the obligation to comply with and to implement. And if even one agency say we are not able to implement a provision, then we would refrain from doing so. And we also have an inter-agency process. So the foreign ministry is usually in favor, but some other domestic agency may have some concern. And we believe in consensus. Unless there's a consensus in a family, we would not ratify, you know.
Thank you. By the way, I'm Louis Stryker from Harvard. You were Nature before.
So thank you. We are going to break in just a moment, but I'd like to just reflect on some of what we've heard. From the person who chaired the two largest conferences that successfully concluded, conferences of almost unimaginable complexity in numbers, in ideology, in interests, in narratives, in perspectives, in constituencies, just vast complexity. And those of us who study negotiation tend to think in much simpler terms. But as we listen to Ambassador Koh, I think there is a set of guidelines and insights and advice that could be so valuable in other multilateral conferences. And frankly, whether it's on the Arctic, whether it's on trade, whether it's on specific environmental issues, on privacy, on many, many issues that clearly call for global solutions, the track record has not been great. But if you think about the principles of organizing these, of chairing them effectively, of building momentum, of creating the necessary crises, of handling holdouts, anticipating spoilers, of somehow doing this in a way that keeps your credibility and people want to work with you and on behalf of this larger purpose, I think we really have a great deal of wisdom. So for that, for this session, we'll take about a half an hour break and then come back with more of a bilateral focus on a bit on the Singapore U.S. free trade deal, on mediation between the Russian Federation and the Baltics, and with Professor Nick Burns, we'll be looking at some of the other really challenging negotiations. Okay. Susan, Ambassador Koh, you guys, thanks very much. We'll reconvene.
Thanks, Tom. Thank you. Thank you.
We'll reconvene at 3:30.